Once again, my name is Chris Meckley from ACI Aquaculture. I hope you enjoy this short segment on Discosoma mushrooms. Discosoma mushrooms have always been something that I've enjoyed. I'm more of a hard coral guy, but when it comes to softies, Discosoma mushrooms are coming in such a variety of colors. It blows me away when my suppliers send me something that I've never seen before, and we did get some in just this week that I've never seen anything like them before. They're absolutely gorgeous. We're gonna see them here in this video. But one of the things that is very highly sought after in the Discosoma family is the jawbreaker mushroom. And there's names on a couple of these other ones. I don't know the names of these things very well. Maybe Richard can tell you what they are. There's this new one that came in that is pink and green and white and yellow. It's absolutely stunning. I can't wait for you guys to see the picture of it or the video of it. Fairly easy animals to keep. Unless you're buying a jawbreaker mushroom. Jawbreakers, for some reason, even though they're Discosoma, for one, when I bring them in, they come from Indonesia. They're very difficult to ship. We always hold them for at least a week or two before we offer them to anybody. Most of the time, if we don't put them in no flow at all in very low light, they come right off the rock that they're attached to. I have no idea why. I hope somebody someday can tell me why. But once they settle in and I reattach, they're really easy to keep. I know it's very common in the industry for people to take some of the most beautiful jawbreakers I've ever seen and frag them up, and then it allows them to offer a piece of that same mushroom. We don't do that. We tend to either hoard them in my wife's aquarium or allow customers just to take them about a week after we receive them in. The one that I'm talking about that is pink and green and white and yellow, I keep staring at it, just catches my eye every time I just look to the right a little bit. Absolutely stunning animal. That came in perfect. Wide open, healthy, and that is the way it is with the majority of Discosomas when we receive them in. We can get them in and they're wide open and happy and healthy immediately. It seems to be that always the most highly sought after, rare color morphs of every species that we get are always the touchiest and ship the hardest. Of course, our suppliers usually know that, so we make sure that extra precautions are going, more water is put into the bag for them to be shipped over here so that we can offer these beautiful animals to the hobbyists or to the retail stores that then can offer them to the hobbyists. Care level wise, I've kept Discosomas in super intense metal halides with Acroporas and Montes. I've kept them all the way down to very low par, like the jawbreakers in my sump in the back that we had issues with. When they came in, they go down there, they settle in, they attach, they start growing babies, and then we put them out for sale. Again, not a hard animal to keep alive as long as you get a healthy specimen. Something to look for when you're purchasing one, make sure that its foot's fully attached to the substrate that it is on. If it is lifting at all, don't buy it. I don't recommend anybody to buy it because I've seen it 1,000 times, actually probably multiply that by 100. I've seen so many Discosoma mushrooms come in. If they're not stuck to the rock completely, more than likely they're gonna come off that rock, especially if they're putting in high flow. It's not a good scenario, especially if it's an expensive little jawbreaker mushroom or even one of these little guys here. It's risky. If you've got a green thumb for keeping corals, take it at your own risk. It's 50-50 sometimes. Another thing to look for in a good specimen is, when we bring them in, sometimes they've been in the bags for 48, 50, 60 hours, and their mouths are wide open, and you can see this little stringy, looks like spaghetti coming out of their mouth. We get concerned when we see that, but most of the time, that gets pulled back in, the mouth puckers up nice and tight, and the animal's healthy. If you're in a store looking at a specimen, it doesn't matter how gorgeous that specimen is, if its mouth isn't tight and you see those little spaghetti looking things or its guts coming out of it, don't buy it. You're crazy. It should be closed up tight, especially if the store had it since the day before or weeks beforehand. If it just came in, let it sit there till the next day. Go back and take a look at it and make sure that the animal has that pulled back in and the mouth is tightened up, because sometimes that can be an issue of, you know, they are anemones, and I've seen anemones come in, look absolutely happy and healthy, and then their gut starts spewing out of them and they're dead in 24 hours after we receive them. They do ship hard sometimes. And again, make sure the mouth is really tight and the foot's attached, and you will have great success with the purchase of your discosoma mushroom. Love them. It's a shame some of these have gone from being inexpensive to super expensive, but again, that is the way it is with anything, supply and demand. And the really, really rare color morphs are very hard to come by, and we're very fortunate that we have some really amazing suppliers out of Indonesia and Bali that make sure that we get amazing specimens on every single shipment that we bring in, and sometimes it's two or three shipments a week that we get them in on. Only thing I know that I can think of would maybe be the little planarian flatworms. They're really not going to eat the coral, but I've gotten corals from my suppliers where they're on the rocks, and of course, yes, they can get on the coral itself. They're more of a nuisance. If they become an epidemic, meaning they're covering the entire coral, they will just keep it from getting light, which will eventually harm the animal. Since discosomas are normally very hardy, a quick swish for 2 seconds in fresh water usually takes those things right away. Or if you're concerned about that, using the fresh water on them, whatever you use is your normal coral dip. Iodine will remove them. I don't know. There's so many different coral dips out there. We've got our methods in here that we use, and we know they work. A lot of people don't like them. Bare and fresh water is our main thing, because it's not very harmful to the animal, especially if you know how to do it. And it removes the pests or the irritants, per se, from the discosomas. But again, easy to keep. Just the rock that it comes on could have a pest on it. So you still, like I've always said in the past, quarantine it, even though it's just a small mushroom, even if it's only just a frag plug. You know, it's not going to hurt you to quarantine it. Patience, 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 and you don't have to worry about, or you have to worry about it, but it's less likely to worry as much if you quarantine the animal before it goes into your aquarium. I do know that iodine is something that is a necessity for the majority of soft corals, actually all corals. And the big misconception of iodine is when you add it, it stays in your system. Iodine bonds very quickly with nutrients, especially nitrates. If you have nitrates in your water and you dose your iodine and you think that dosing it once a week is okay, it's not. If you have nitrates in your water, you need to dose iodine probably darn near every single day, because it's going to be removed fairly quickly by bonding up with the nutrients in your system. You can overdose iodine, and overdosing iodine can cause a wide variety of issues. But again, if you have nutrients in your water, like nitrates and phosphates, they're going to remove it fairly quickly. What we do in here, because we do run our nitrates at around 5 to 8, because in a lot of our systems they're running very low light on them, and we grow SPS really well with the low light, and the balance of nutrients and light is very key. I dose iodine in here. I don't let anybody else do it. It's one of the only things that is my job to dose on a almost daily basis. Between 2,000 gallon systems, I put 1 mL of iodine almost daily. Some of the more colorful ones come from deeper water, so they don't like a lot of light. That is probably the only other tip that I can give you. The less light they have, the bigger they get, the faster they grow babies. And of course, the reason why people get jawbreakers, a lot of people, they want to be able to grow that baby off and offer it to a friend for free, or trade, or try to sell it back to their local store and make a couple of bucks so they can keep adding to their tank. It's an expensive hobby, so if you can do that, you know, I recommend it. Once again, my name is Chris Meckley from ACI Aquaculture. I hope you enjoy this short segment on discosoma mushrooms. Are they going to be happier with the water parameters like you would keep an SPS tank? Damn right they are.